seated. We'd like to welcome you to online worship. Just a quick note for all of you, Pastor Amy was exposed to someone with COVID and is not here today. She will return next week. We will not have online service next week as our technical people will be out of town. So we hope you join us following after that. I'm going to do an offering for the prayer, or prayer for the offering. God of power and might, through the ages you have reminded us through prophets and apostles that we are called to battle, not with one another, but against the powers of darkness and evil. It is this battle that sends children to bed with empty bellies, while others have so much food it damages their health. It is the battle that imprisons those who only crime is poverty, while those with more than they could ever spend lose sleep scheming how to get more. As we make our gifts to you this day, may we remember on which side we're on. In the precious, loving name of Christ, we pray. Amen. We will not be doing the offering plates. There is a box in the fellowship hall that we would like you to place your tithes in. We will now hum the doxology.
I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. Give us wisdom and understanding as we open the word today. Amen. Would you stand for the reading of the scripture? This is Ephesians 6:10-20. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all of the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given me, so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Well, my name is Carla Wrighton, and my husband and I moved here 4 years ago. We have a lake place on Lake Seven. And before that, we lived in Minot, North Dakota, and I was a TV newscaster for 30 plus years. So I've done the news a lot of times, but I've never done a sermon before. But when Amy calls, you don't say no. So she said, can you stand and read my sermon? So it's her words, her message, my voice. When I first started looking at this text, I skipped the most important sentence, the first sentence. I ignored it and blew right by it, and it skewed my whole understanding of this passage. It's a little like missing the first step on a flight of stairs. So let's talk about that first verse and set out on the right footing. The first verse is, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Paul begins his final chapter of Ephesians calling on all his listeners to be strengthened by the strength the Lord gives, period. He is reminding everyone that God's mighty power is there for us to draw on, rest in, and utilize when facing life's difficulties and facing evil. If we miss that understanding that God gives strength and will strengthen us all along each step of the way, the rest of the chapter sounds like something we have to do in our own strength. We might be tempted to view the weapons as something we use to attack the enemy, and it distorts how we are to be encouraged and actually stand firm. We are going to keep that first sentence front and center. As we look at this whole passage, I believe there are at least four main ways that Paul desires to encourage us. First, we are encouraged in being reminded that we don't have to be defeated by evil. We can stand up under whatever comes as we lean on to the Lord's strength. Then we are encouraged that even though we have a real and powerful enemy, Christ's power is greater. And we are encouraged as we learn we have superior weapons and that Christ spiritually empowers us and is with us in the heat of a crisis. Finally, we are encouraged to remember prayer changes things. Prayer allows us to access God's mighty aid. Prayer helps us to keep the proper attitude when facing evil or a challenging or taxing situation that truly tests our faith. Prayer helps us stay focused on serving the Lord and his purposes for us. Paul is giving us these four encouragements to help us succeed in reaching his main goal for us. So what is our main goal? In verses 11, 13, and 14, we are given this consistent command. We are to stand firm. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of the evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground and after you have done everything to stand. And then in verse 14, stand firm then. Four times, Paul repeats himself so that we might catch what he is calling us to do. Paul's desire for us to stand firm doesn't really add up to a hill of beans if we aren't facing a difficulty or dealing with a struggle of some kind. Paul's audience, though, was facing huge struggles. Paul is offering encouragement because of that time. Remember, Christians were completely vulnerable to oppression and persecution under the Romans. We have to remember that the Christian faith was illegal until 311 AD. But what about us? Well, I believe we are being called to stand firm as the Delta variant infects and the numbers surge around us. That's one of the evils of our day. We are still reeling from the last year under the virus, and now it's back. How can we stand firm and know we are going to get through this? In verses 11 and 13, Paul provides the answer his listeners were desperate for. Paul teaches them how they can actually achieve the goal of standing firm. In an extended metaphor, Paul tells them twice to put on the full armor of God. This armor that is from God is spiritual because the work this armor must do is spiritual in nature. This armor is from a superior equipper, meaning God. This armor is far superior than anything anyone has ever seen. When we put on the armor, we don't have to experience defeat. We can stand against the devil's schemes and stand strong in the day of evil. We can know victory because this armor is really just another poetic way of saying God will give us strength. Putting on this armor is the role we must play in working with God to stand firm. Putting on the armor God gives us is taking up a mindset in how we look at the world. It is assessing the Lord's strength in prayer, requires us to take action, it engages our faith, causes us to pull together and believe God will bring us through. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. First, we have to face our enemy. In verse 12, Paul describes our enemy in detail. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Immediately, we are reminded our enemy is not other humans, because something about it just wants us to blame another person. I can imagine our bishop is being blamed for the yellow phase, or maybe the Ad Council for following the bishop's recommendation. It's human nature to want to blame somebody else, to point fingers. It's Biden's fault, it's Trump's fault, it's our governor's fault. Let's blame the bishop or the Ad Councils or the pastor. But I hope that's not the case. Instead of blaming humans, we are reminded that though our enemy is real, he is not made up of flesh and blood. No, our real enemy is actually spiritual and often invisible. Our enemy is powerful and evil, but not invincible, and has already been defeated. Is our enemy evil personified, Satans and demons? Is our enemy an inanimate evil, like COVID, for instance? Is our enemy generalized evil moving against nations, states, and cities, or a specific devil directed at us personally? Yes, no, maybe, but it doesn't matter. Our response is still the same. We are to stand firm. And we have two main reasons why we can stand firm. First, Christ is above all other powers. In the verse in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20, we read, "He raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion." And later, "God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything." Jesus is far stronger than Satan. Satan has been defeated. And 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 reminds us, "You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world." Secondly, our weapons are superior. We can be confident and be encouraged that we will pull through the second wave of the virus, because our spiritual weapons can defeat our spiritual enemy in whatever form evil takes. Historically, we know that the spear defeated the knife, the bow defeated the spear, heavy armor defeated the bow, the cavalry defeated the foot soldiers, and tanks defeated the cavalry, and rifles defeated bows. The gun and cannons defeated rifles. It just goes on and on. Historically, the armory with the best weapons usually won. Paul is encouraging all the churches and all the Christians that they can take the field and stay firm. They can be confident that in the day of evil, they will remain standing, they will prevail, because their weapons and armor are far better. Paul had a unique perspective on Roman weapons and armor. He wrote Ephesians as he was under house arrest and chained to Roman guards 24 hours a day. He had an up-close and consistent reminder of the most powerful army in the world at the time. Rome's strength was built squarely on the most physically intimidating and best-equipped foot soldier that the world had ever seen, until Paul arrived. Paul knew God's armor, and the weapons he encourages his brothers and sisters to take up were far, far better. Christians were now the best-equipped army the world has or will ever see, because our strength is in the Lord Almighty. I know some people like to do a deep dive into the variety of weapons Paul describes in verses 14 through 17, talking about the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, and so on. But Paul is using an extended metaphor to underscore all that a Christian has in being untied to God through Christ. We could lose the forest for the trees if we were not careful. We could get so caught up in the details of the helmet, shield, sword, belt, and sandals that we forget it just all means our strength comes from God. Our weapons are really God's strength graciously provided when we are in need, if we so choose. Which, as we conclude, brings us back to Paul and the choices he made. Paul was under house arrest and facing a possible death sentence for his faith in Christ. If anyone had a valid reason to complain, Paul would have a case. And if anyone could slip into despair and negativity, not feel like they had any control over their lives, Paul again could really make a strong case. But that is not what Paul does. In fact, Paul didn't even ask for people to pray that he would be released from his difficult circumstances. Instead, he chose to look at his circumstances from a Christian perspective and turn them into an opportunity to encourage others to turn to God and continue to grow spiritually. I admire how he didn't let anything stop him. I admire what he chose to do. He chose to encourage and strengthen others. He chose to call Christians to pull together and stand firm. He chose to remember, with God, our weapons are superior and victory assured, because God is all-powerful and will help us. He chose to pray and ask for prayer. Even when he chose to ask for prayer, it was to ask if he would be made a stronger person and bolder, more bolder than his difficulty. What an amazing response. I believe Paul ends his encouragement to stand firm with four reminders to pray, because prayer is what helps us connect to God and access the strength that God provides. Turning to prayer, calling out God in prayer, praying for God's help to weather this latest storm is a good way to respond to this passage. Let us pray on all occasions with all kinds of prayers, and keep on praying for all of God's people. Pray that we might choose, like Paul, to pray not so much for the virus to be eradicated from the face of the earth, but pray to be made stronger and bolder than any of these difficulties. Let us pray to remember that the Lord, as our strength, will stand firm. Let us pray. Dear Lord, help us be strong in your mighty power. Help us to put on your armor against all the evil around us, while at the same time opening our hearts to all the joys around us. And be with Pastor Amy as she prepares to come back to us next week. In the name we pray. Amen. And you may stand for our next hymn.
Make known the mystery of the gospel. Keep alert and pray at all times. Draw strength from God's power, and so stand firm against all that would corrupt you. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Amen. Yes.
Thank you, God, for the rain we
received. Yes, amen.
I actually saw people taking pictures because people out of state, and sending them to people out of state because they didn't believe it was actually raining here. All right, have a great week, you guys.